Hello learners, this is your chemistry tutor Charles Kwame Bando. It's good to come to your way again. We met on unit 1 and as I told you, I'm handling this course with Mr. Stephen Kwame Amaku. So we met in unit 1 and he also handled unit 2 and I have come again to you on unit 3. Good. Now we are moving away from the molar masses, though we will use or employ the services of what you have done, but we are looking at concentration of a solution. Concentration of a solution. Now here, is it some of this thing that we are learning? Some of us may not see the necessity of this, but you realize that if you are to study chemistry to a higher level, realize that if you do pharmacy, these things are very keen. A slightest mistake a chemist will do, or a pharmacist will do in mixing of drugs, can kill masses of human beings, even to the like 0.0001 mistake will kill a lot of people who take that particular drug or whatever is involved. So here, this concentration and other thing that we are very important in our dealings. And at times, even in your home, when your soup is so salty, what do? You pour water into the soup, and you don't know that when you are doing that, you don't remove the salt, but you rather change the concentration of the salt. And when you do that, you don't feel the salt as it was, but you also realize that the volume of your soup has gone up. And this is chemistry you apply in the home, but you don't see it. But let me now inform you that when you do that, you are only applying chemistry. Alright, so let's move on. So what then is concentration of a solution? Concentration of a solution. Now we are saying that concentration of a solution is the amount of substance dissolved in 1 decimeter cube of solution. Amount of substance dissolved in 1 decimeter cube of solution. That is basically concentration of solution. So in your soup, if I want to look at concentration of your soup and in relation to salt, then I'm looking at how much of salt you put in your soup. If I should take a decimeter cube of your soup, how much of salt did you put in there? And that is looking at the concentration of the salt in the soup, right? Basically, we give the symbol C for concentration and then has a unit of mole per decimeter cube. Though we have types of concentration, but this is the one that is widely used. Alright, so mathematically, we are saying that concentration is given by quantity of solution, quantity of solute. We look at what a solute is, quantity of solute per unit volume of solution. Quantity of, so you can even define concentration as quantity of solute per unit volume of solution. So if you are looking at the soup example, then the salt will now be the solute, and then the whole of the soup will be the solution. We are only ignoring the faces and all other things. I'm only looking at the salt in there. Alright. Good. So let's see the various types of concentration. We have what we call the mass concentration or gram concentration. Mass concentration or gram concentration. Here, the amount of substance we are looking at is supposed to be in grams. So we are saying that mass concentration is the amount of substance in gram dissolved per unit volume of solution. And this unit volume of solution is the 1 decimeter cube. Right. So that as soon as the amount of substance is in grams, then we are looking at the mass concentration. And so mathematically, quantity of solute in grams per volume. And so we are using the symbol rho, R-H-O, rho. And rho is mass over volume. And realize that this is the same formula we use for density. So it is telling you that mass concentration basically looking at density, right? The unit is gram per decimeter cube. Gram per decimeter cube. Now let's look at the molar concentration. Molar concentration. This time, the quantity of solute is in moles and then being dissolved in 1 decimeter cube of solution. So molar concentration, the quantity of solute in moles dissolved in 1 dm cube of solution. So here we are looking at molar concentration. So the formula or the relation is that we have quantity of solute in moles divided by volume in decimeter cube. And so we have C is equal to N over V. Now, we are going to show you how this molar concentration relates to mass concentration. And so, we are saying that molar concentration is equal to mass concentration over molar mass. Let me tell you that this is so because if I am to take the number of moles, small n, in the formula C is equal to N over V, then you remember very well that that particular small n is equal to mass small m divided by molar mass. And so if I do substitution in C is equal to N over V, if I place n by m, small m over capital M, then I am going to have C is equal to small m divided by V times capital M. And so if I separate and have small m over V times 1 over M, I am going to have small m over V representing the mass or gram concentration. And so that will divide, that will be divided by molar mass. And that will give us C is equal to rho over big M. And so that is the relationship between mass concentration, molar mass, and then molar concentration. So there are times you'll be asked to calculate any of them, giving you the other two. Alright, so please take note. It follows that this rho will be equal to C times M, or mass concentration will be equal to molar concentration times molar mass. Alright. So the unit of molar concentration is mole per decimeter cube. Sometimes you will see 2 capital M. It represents 2 molar. We mentioned it as 2 molar. And that 2 molar is referring to molar concentration. Right. So instead of writing a whole mole per dm cube, you are just represented by capital M. And that capital M is not molar mass, but it is mole per decimeter cube. So take note of that. Right. Now let's see a work example. When 0.2 moles, no, so before I continue with the work example, let me also mention that concentration can be given in part per million, ppm, and even sometimes part per billion. But per the curriculum we are using, we may not be look at part per million and part per billion. But then you can study outside the box a bit, and then you enhance your understanding as far as concentration is concerned. So try to read on ppm and then ppb, that part per million and then part per billion. All right. That is for concentration when it is given in smaller quantities, right? So we are, let's look at our work example. When 0.2 moles of sodium trioxocarbonate for it dissolved in water to make 0.5 dm cube of solution, calculate the concentration of solution, right? Now looking at the information given to you, although we were not told whether to calculate for molar concentration or gram concentration, but then per definition of molar concentration and per the information given to us, you realize that the quantity of solute that was dissolved in water to make 0.5 decimeter cube is in moles, and so our concentration should be the molar concentration, right? So we have N 0.2 and then V 0.5. So using our formula, C is equal to N over V, we do our substitution in moles and then in decimeter cube, and then our answer is nicely giving us 0.4 mole per decimeter cube. I can also write 0.4 capital M to represent the whole of mole per dm cube, and you pronounce that as 0.4 molar. All right, I hope you are clear with this simple calculation that we have done, right? All right, let us look at this work example as well. And here we are looking at calculate the molar concentration if 15 grams of sodium hydroxide is dissolved in 2 decimeter cube of solution. The atomic masses have also been given unto us. And so if here we were not asked to calculate for molar concentration, we could have just do 15 over 2 and then we have our gram concentration. But the question is specifically on molar concentration, so we have to do exact. And so here there are two ways, and one of them is that I can use C is equal to N over V. Then because I don't have my number of moles, I will use the previous formula, N is equal to small m over big M, where big M is the molar mass and small m is the mass given to us. So that I'll calculate my number of moles somewhere, and then I bring the answer to N over V, then I'll get my final answer. Or I can just substitute mass over molar mass into N over C, so that I'll have M over V times M, and that is 15 divided by 2 times 40, and so that will give us 0.1875 mole per decimeter cube. One of the ways you can also do this is to calculate for your gram concentration first. And per definition of gram concentration, we have mass over volume, so it will be 15 divided by 2. And so when we do 15 divided by 2 to have our 7.5, then since the relation between mass concentration and molar concentration, that molar concentration is equal to mass concentration over molar mass, so I'll divide my 7.5 by 40, and it will still give me 0.1875 mole per decimeter cube, and so that will give you the same answer. All right, now we have our example 3, and in example 3 we are looking at concentration in gram per decimeter cube, that is mass concentration. And in A, we have 20 grams of sodium hydroxide dissolved in 5 decimeter cube of solution. And in B, we have 0.5 moles of sodium hydroxide dissolved in 800 centimeter cube of solution. So the A part is very simple, because per definition of gram concentration or mass concentration, we say quantity of solute in grams per volume in decimeter cube. So in A, we are going to have concentration as rho is equal to M over V, and M is 20 grams and V is 5 decimeter cube. So we have 4 gram per decimeter cube. Now the B part is where the problem is. Here our solute is given in moles and volume is given in centimeter cube. So we have also been given atomic masses. So we need to do a little work before we can arrive at our final answer or our destination. So here we need to change 800 centimeter cube into decimeter cube. And the relationship between 800 centimeter cube and decimeter cube is that 1 decimeter cube is equal to 1000 centimeter cube. So take note of that. And so here we need to look for how we can change the number of moles into grams before we can go ahead with our calculation. So we have our mass concentration, which is equal to mass over volume. But mass is equal to number of moles times molar mass. So I need to bring these two on board, and then I'll have 0.4, which is the number of moles, times 40, which is the molar mass of sodium hydroxide, and that will represent the mass, which is small m, and we divide by 0.8, and the 0.8 is in decimeter cube. Remember that 800 centimeter cube is the same as 0.8 in decimeter cube. Divide by 1000, and the final answer is 20 gram per decimeter cube. 20 gram per decimeter cube. So please take note of the differences. If it's given to you in centimeter cube, you have to change it quickly to the decimeter cube. Right. Now we have another work example. And in this work example, we have been asked to look for what volume of solution would have a concentration of 0.01 mole per dm cube when 5.0 grams of calcium hydroxide is completely dissolved in it. So the question is demanding for volume. So we are looking at when 5 grams of calcium hydroxide is dissolved in a certain volume of solution, the concentration given was 0.01. So what volume is that? Now the information given to us, we have the concentration, we have the mass, and we have atomic masses. So we need to look for molar mass of calcium hydroxide, and that is 74 gram per mole. So we are going to have our usual relation C is equal to N over V. Now remember that N is the same as M, small m over capital M, so mass over molar mass. So when I do substitution, when I substitute mass over molar mass for number of moles, I am going to have C is equal to mass over volume times molar mass. Mass over volume times molar mass. And that is going to give me 5 over 0.01 times 74. 5 over 0.01 times 74. And that is going to give us 6.757 decimeter cube. 6.757 decimeter cube. So this is the volume of the solution which gave us 0.01 mole per decimeter cube when 5 grams of calcium hydroxide was dissolved in it. Right, that's the final volume. If you ask to change it to centimeter cube, you only multiply by 1000 and it will give you 6757 centimeter cube. Alright, so this is how. So it is not always that calculate for concentration. There are times you'll be asked to look for the volume, or sometimes you can even be asked to look for the number of moles in that regard, depending on whoever is examining you. Right. Now, another example that calculates the mass concentration of 0.75 molar H2SO4. Calculate the mass concentration of 0.75 molar H2SO4. You see here, you are looking for mass concentration, alright, but per definition of mass concentration, we say that quantity of solute in gram per unit volume of solution. But volume has not been given, mass has not also been given. So we cannot go by using that particular relation. But remember that I gave you another relation. We say that molar concentration is equal to mass concentration divided by molar mass. Or you can say mass concentration is equal to molar concentration times molar mass. So we are going to employ the surfaces of that particular relation. Good. So we have our molar concentration, which is 0.75 molar. And we have our molar mass, which is also 98 gram per mole. And so from rho is equal to C times M, we are going to have 0.75 times 98, and that will give us 73.5 grams per decimeter cube. So here we have gotten our mass concentration without using volume and without using mass, but using molar concentration and molar mass. So this is also another way to look for mass concentration. Good. Now remember that in everything we do, I try to give you trial questions so that after you have been able to do, you now call yourself a master on whatever we have done or we are doing. So one, how many moles of KMnO4 are in 40 centimeter cube of 100 mole per decimeter cube KMnO4? That is potassium tetraozomanganate 7. So here you are looking for a number of moles in that regard. Now there's two ways that the concentration of sodium chloride in blood serum is approximately 0.14 molar. What volume of blood serum contains 20 grams of NaCl? So you have been given the atomic masses, so you also work on that. And then three, how many grams of HCl are in 225 centimeter cube of 6.0 molar HCl? Look on that also. Now the fourth one is that the label on a jar of jam says that it contains 30 grams of sucrose, C11H22O11 per tablespoon, that is 15 ml. What is the molarity of sucrose in the jam? So here you are looking for molarity, which is the same as the molar concentration. So I leave you with this. Try your hands on them and then it will inform you of your states about what you have learned in concentration. Good. Now, as I told you, I'll be looking at preparation of solution in our latest law when I started my facts on moles. So let's look at some terminologies in preparation of solution. The very first one is the word solution. Solution is nothing but a homogeneous mixture of two or more substances. A homogeneous mixture. So the emphasis is on homogeneous mixture of two or more substances. So a solution is formed when a solvent is dissolved in a solute, or when a solute dissolves. So when a solvent dissolves a solute, or a solute is dissolved in solvent, yes. So once there is a homogeneous mixture, you talk of solution. Otherwise, you cannot talk about solution, because if I put sand in water, I can still see the sand particles, so that is not a solution. But if I put sugar in water, you cannot, with time, the sugar dissolves completely and you cannot distinguish the sugar from the water, so that is a solution. That is a homogeneous mixture of salt and water, or sugar and water. And so when you have a solute that is being dissolved in a solvent, you have a solute. So that if I put sugar in water and stir it completely for sugar to dissolve, the result is called solution. But the sugar I put in is my solute, and then the water becomes the solvent. Alright. So a solute is a substance that is able to dissolve in a solvent. And then the solvent is the liquid that is able to dissolve the solute. So water, kerosene are examples of solvents. So water is able to dissolve most of the ionic compounds, but Kerosene is also able to dissolve most of the covalent compound. Alright, so water is a solvent and kerosene is also a solvent. Good. Now let's look at various types of solution that we have. We have a dilute solution. So mostly when you prepare your soup, and as I said, it is too much concentrated of either salt or even the various ingredients in the soup. If you leave it on water for long and the amount of water in it is able to evaporate, you realize that you have a higher concentration of the ingredient. So what you do is to put in more water or add more water, and that you are saying that, oh, I am diluting the soup. So a dilute solution is any solution which has a small amount of salt in a large volume of solvent. So if I put small sugar in a large water, you may not even feel the taste of sugar there. And that is a dilute solution. Now we have also what you mean by concentrated solution. Now in concentrated solution, I have a large volume or large amount of solute dissolved in a given volume of solution. So here the larger or the bigger the amount of solute in the solution, you have more concentrated the solution is. So if I have more salt dissolved in a small volume of water, I am going to have concentrated solution. So when you taste the salt, it's so you can feel it and realize that it is much, right? We also have what we call saturated solution. Saturated solution is any solution which cannot dissolve any solute at a particular temperature. Please, here the particular temperature in it is very important, because when you change the temperature of a particular solution, it can dissolve additional solute. So it's just like when you are, let's say you are eating fufu and you are so full. When fufu is brought to you, you say, oh, I am okay. But you see that you can take in ice cream. What it means that you are saturated as far as fufu is concerned, but as far as ice cream is concerned, you are not saturated. So a saturated solution is only saturated at a particular temperature. As soon as you change the temperature, it can dissolve additional. So if we are talking about saturated solution without a particular temperature, it is an error. So make sure that you define it in that regard. Now, unsaturated solution is any solution which can dissolve more solute when added. That's like you are not satisfied. So when more food is given, you just take it on and off. You just eat it anyhow because you are hungry. So that one, you are just not saturated. So you take it as and when it comes. Now we have what you mean by what you call standard solution. A standard solution is a solution whose concentration can be known exactly. It can be known exactly. So you see, sometimes you do your calculation and you realize that the concentration is somewhere you are, even when you were calculating for the mass, you realize that you had something plenty decimal place, so you have to cut it short. And as soon as you do that, your concentration may be known but not exact. But for a standard solution, you can have it exactly known. Alright, so when you have any solution whose concentration can be known exactly, that becomes a standard solution, right? So let's look at how we can prepare a solution. If we were to be in school, had it not been the outbreak of COVID-19, we could have gone to the lab and then practically show you how this can be done. However, we will employ the services of this, and then at least you learn something. When you come back or when we resume, we can now do the practical work, right? So in preparation of solution, you need to take into account this precaution. If you don't know a liquid, do not use that particular liquid to wash your hand. Because some liquids like acid, like bases are corrosive. They can cause a skin burn. So do not use it to wash your hand unless you know exactly what the liquid is before you do that. And then also, we don't drink any liquid in the laboratory. Even it is not good to eat in the lab, neither to drink in the lab. So do not drink an unknown liquid in the laboratory. They can be toxic. So if you are in the lab and you are thirsty or you want to eat, go outside quickly, find food to eat and come back. But before you go out, make sure you wash your hand with clean water and soap before you go out to eat, because you may have contaminated yourself or your hands with these toxic substances, right? And it's also important to wear gloves anytime you go to the lab. Alright, so apart from the precaution that you need to take, let us look at the various apparatus that we use in preparation of our solution. So we have a weighing balance, or the chemical balance, which we are going to use to measure our solute. We also have the spatula, which we are going to use to fetch. It's just a spoon-like apparatus. So we are going to use that to fetch the solute from the container. We also have the fermenting flask, which is going to take or contain the final solution. We have a beaker that we are going to use to dissolve the salt before we transfer into the fermenting flask. We also have a wash bottle for which it will contain the distilled water. We have a stirring rod that we will be using to stir our solution. There is also other things like the funnel, which is going to help us when we are transferring. Alright. Now let's look at the steps involved in the preparation of the solution. We have the very first step that we need to calculate for the molar mass of the solution. So molar mass of the solute. Now the reason for this is that, let's assume that I want to prepare a standard solution of sodium chloride. I have a large quantity in a container. So how much do I fetch to prepare my solution? And to know that the mass that I need to fetch, the first thing I need to do is to look for my molar mass of sodium chloride. Now when I finish that, I now go ahead to calculate for the mass in grams. And so the relation I will use is that mass is equal to concentration times molar mass times volume. Don't forget that when we were calculating for molar concentration, we saw a relation that we have m, which is mass over molar mass times volume. So when we make change of subject for m, then you are going to have c times capital M times volume, and that is what we are going to use to do calculation. So I use that to do my calculation. When I finish, the next step is to weigh this particular mass I have calculated for. And so if it is sodium chloride, I now weigh that mass of sodium chloride. And then, I now dissolve. The next step is to dissolve the mass I have calculated for in about 250 centimeter cube of distilled water in clean, dry beaker. Clean, dry beaker. Now I am using 250 centimeter cube because my total mass that I am dealing with, so my total volume I am dealing with, that total volume is 1000 centimeter cube. So if I pick 250, it will be of no problem. But for instance, if your total volume for your solution you are preparing is about 100 centimeter cube, then I'm afraid you cannot use 250. So depending on the total volume, you take a specific amount of water to dissolve your solute for the first time, right? Now when I finish, I need to transfer this dissolved solute into my fermenting flask. And because it is a standard solution, don't forget that a standard solution is a solution whose concentration is known exactly. And so here the volume is 1000 centimeter cube or 1 decimeter cube. So my flask is 1 decimeter cube volumetric flask. So I transfer the resulting solution to that. When I finish, I need to add more distilled water to reach. There's a mark on the volumetric flask which is up to 1000 centimeters. So you have to gently, when you are about getting closer, you need to pour the or add the water drop by drop. So as you watch the meniscus, as soon as it is up to the mark, you now stop it, cover the flask, shake it well, gently to dissolve all the particles.
Right.
Now this is a video, a short video that is going to show us how it's been done in the lab. Because we are not in the lab now, I employ the service of this video for you to know what I am talking about practically. So let's watch the video and then we come back. Right, so this time you are using the weighing balance to calculate the mass of the soil. So the weighing balance or the chemical balance is, so he's using the spatula to fetch, you see that his well goes, and so after that we transfer what we have weighed into a clean dry beaker. That is the wash bottle with the still water. So he has to wash off all the soil that may have stuck into the container that was used in the measurement of the solute. Right. So he has to add a bit of water. Right. Just to make sure the solute is dissolved. Good. So you have to shake it. Right. Now you have to transfer, that is the volumetric flow. This one is 1 decimeter kilometer. So with the help of a funnel, you gently transfer the solute into that flask. And that is the 1000 centimeter kilometer flask. So you have to make sure you rinse off any residue of the solute in the beaker and pour it into the flask. If you don't do that, you change your concentration, and in that case, your solution will no more be a standard solution. Its concentration, you may not even know it. So you see that generally we have to add more water. Now, for this video, he has to now shake it to dissolve the solute completely. He's now dissolving the solute completely before he will top up to, you see now the water is not up to the 100, so the 1000 centimeter cube, the water is not up to the 1000 centimeter cube mark. So gently he is adding more of the water. You see that mark, so when he is about getting closer, he has to be gentle. So you just watch, the mark is there. Just watch it carefully. So you see that now he's getting closer to the mark. So you have to be done gently, drop by drop. Drop by drop, as you watch the meniscus of the water to be in line with the mark. Right. Okay, so you realize that now the meniscus is in line with the 1000 centimeter cube. So that is the end of the solution. So you have to now stop the addition of water as you have stopped adding. So you close the flask and then make sure you dissolve the solution completely as he is shaking it. Gently, if you don't do it gently, you may just destroy this. Okay, so that is basically how a standard solution can be. So if we were to be in the lab, we could have also gone through the same process. Right, I believe the video has helped. So let's continue our lesson. Good, so this is what we saw. So we have our weighing balance, the stern rod, because so the arrows are showing the step from the beginning to the last. So this is just the step you saw in the video. So I wouldn't waste much time here. The video has taught us almost everything we need to know on this slide. Right. Now let's look at how we can prepare 1 dm cube of 0.2 molar sodium hydroxide quickly, and then we go. Now apparatus, I wouldn't waste time in mentioning it because we have seen how these apparatus have been used. And so I calculate my mass of sodium hydroxide. So the number of moles is 0.2. Since we are looking at 1 decimeter cube, then the number of moles will be 0.2. Molar mass is 40 gram per mole. So I use this formula to get my mass. So I have concentration, which is 0.2, volume 1, and then my molar mass 40. That will give me 8 grams. So I now fetch 8 grams. In other words, I weigh 8 grams of sodium hydroxide with the balance and then dissolve it in the seawater in the beaker as we saw. When I finish, I then pour it in my 1 dm cube or 1000 centimeter cube flask as we saw. And then I shake it well, top it up with more distilled water until my 1000 cm cube mark is reached, as we just saw in the video. So that is exactly what we are supposed to do here. Right. Thank you very much for your attention. I believe the lesson has been successful. So just watch it. Try as much as possible to try your hands on whatever trial question that I've given. And after that, I have these questions as well on molar solution. So go through them. And if you have any problem, you can reach to us through either the UCC platform or the Google Classroom or even WhatsApp. You can reach to us so that we can address all your issues for you. God bless you so much. Stay blessed.